For thousands of years, humans have bred horses in much the same gradual way nature does. But soon, they could actually be designed in the lab, along with other livestock, plants, and even humans. Because a new technology has made editing the genome almost as easy as using a word processor. Genes are made of DNA, long strings of four chemicals, best known by their initials, A, G, C, and T. Together, they form the basis of all life on Earth. This new genome editing technique is so much faster, easier, and more accurate than anything that's come before that it's creating a new paradigm for biological research. It's called CRISPR, which is short for clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. Here's how it works. Scientists program a guide RNA on a protein called Cas9 with the address of the targeted gene. The guide RNA directs the Cas9 protein to cut both DNA strands precisely at the correct spot, like a molecular scalpel. A new section of DNA is added to the cell and edited into the original DNA sequence, which now incorporates the characteristics of both sequences. Biochemist Jennifer Doudna was one of the co-discoverers of the CRISPR technology.
It's going to enable a lot of science to be done that was impossible to do in the past.
The CRISPR technology is so precise that it can actually edit DNA down to a single letter, and multiple edits can be made at once. Changes in a genome that may previously have taken centuries can now be made in just a short time. This game-changing technology is one of the most powerful in the entire history of science, perhaps comparable to the splitting of the atom. But, like that historic event, the development of easy, cheap, and convenient genome editing may also bring a new and sobering responsibility.
One of the roles that we as scientists need to play is to really communicate the power of this technology and how we can be responsible. Do we know enough about the human genome to understand the impact of making changes to it in a developing embryo?
In fact, the human genome has more than 20,000 genes, many of which we do not understand at all. Doudna has been a cautionary voice, but she is also excited about the possibility of solving big problems.
I think most people would feel that genome editing in adults is, or at least might be, for some applications, a very appropriate technology. It might be analogous to taking a pill for treating cancer or some other disease.
Could we begin to treat previously incurable diseases like sickle cell anemia or cystic fibrosis and do it inexpensively?
I like to call it democratizing technology.
The CRISPR revolution is already happening in research labs worldwide. For better or worse, every life on Earth will soon be affected by our ability to reprogram the software of life.
I want to welcome you to the World Science Festival, and I think what will be a very, very interesting evening. We're going to be diving into the brave new world of CRISPR. And as you see, as you saw in that film, CRISPR gives scientists the awesome power to tinker with the software of life. The system was invented only 3 years ago, but already the rush is on for big bucks and prizes as scientists and industry compete to modify food, develop new drugs, and target genetic diseases. CRISPR biotech startups are springing up around the country, and big industry is on board. They've been ramping up CRISPR research and development in agriculture and pharmaceuticals. Two American universities are battling it out in court over the basic CRISPR patent. And while the legal dust settles, the number of patent applications in the US has jumped from 4 to 230 in just the last 3 years. And everywhere, it seems, people are beginning to imagine a brave new future through CRISPR. Here to help us sort this out are leading researchers and thinkers, some who have a stake in the race for CRISPR. Our first participant is a molecular biologist and director of technology at gene editing company Cybus, where she is responsible for leading a team of scientists developing non-transgenic traits in commercial crops. Please welcome Noel Sauer. Our next guest is professor of pathology and pediatrics at Albert Einstein College of Medicine. He develops new technologies and investigates the genetic basis of common and rare disorders. Please welcome Harry Ostrer. Also with us tonight is a postdoctoral research associate at the Rockefeller University. He has adapted genome editing techniques, including CRISPR, to investigate the genes and neural circuits that control behaviors in the mosquitoes that carry diseases such as dengue, chikungunya, and Zika virus. Please welcome Ben Matthews. Our next participant is director of research at the Hastings Center and an expert on the ethical, legal, and policy implications of biomedical technologies. Please welcome Josie Johnston. Joining us is assistant professor of biochemistry and medicine at the Weill Cornell Medical College. He's a pioneer in using CRISPR gene editing in animal studies. He demonstrated a simple genetic tweak that can turn cancer cells into healthy tissues in a matter of days. Please welcome Luke Dow. And our final guest tonight is a professor of genetics at Harvard Medical School. He directs personalgenomes.org and the NIH Center for Excellence in Genomic Science. His innovations have led to the creation of 12 companies ranging from medical genomics to biosecurity policies. Please welcome George Church. So there's a lot of ground to cover here when it comes to CRISPR, and I have a ton of questions to ask our panelists, and I do hope that you tweet your questions as well at hashtag WSF16 so you can join the conversation. So to start, one of the world's most accomplished biologists, Nobel laureate David Baltimore, has called the discovery of CRISPR a monumental moment in the history of biomedical research. What I'd like to start us off, so people have an understanding, is help us understand the excitement in the scientific world and what is powerful, what is so powerful about CRISPR. So what makes it a game changer? And I'll start with you, George. What is it about CRISPR that's captured everyone's attention?
Well, I'm going to be a little subdued about it, having contributed a little bit. But I think it's a placeholder for a collection of technologies that have not been recognized and suddenly are. This includes next-generation sequencing, a variety of ways of doing gene editing, and gene therapy without editing. All of these things are given the name CRISPR for communication purposes, as I see it. That said, it is very, very easy for academics to use. It is extraordinarily inexpensive, and you know, high school students are doing it.
We'll get into the ease of doing CRISPR. Luke, what's your take?
So I'm a cancer biologist by training, cancer geneticist, and we've been for many years trying to manipulate the genetic information in a model system to try and mimic human cancer. And that's been tedious sometimes, and the tools have been relatively blunt. And now CRISPR allows us to go in and make these changes. And you heard in the introduction, we have tens of thousands of genes. And we need to be able to go and precisely engineer the changes we see in human cancer to understand the biology and find new ways to treat.
And CRISPR gives you a way in to do that?
It does. I mean, as George said, there's been technologies that have led up to CRISPR that have allowed that, but they've sometimes been difficult to implement and not very scalable. So you might spend a long time on one gene. Now we can spend the same amount of time studying 10 or 20 genes. And cancer is extremely complex.
Yeah.
So we need to understand all of that complexity to get a handle on it.
Harry, is the excitement warranted?
The excitement is totally warranted. You know, in addition to these, you know, thousands of genes that we have millions of genetic variations. And for instance, if we sequenced your genome, Rich, we'd find that you have 3.5 million, you know, genetic variants. It's a major challenge that George faces in, you know, the personalized genome project. We don't have a clue of what most of those variants are doing, and CRISPR provides a handle for discerning that.
And Noel, there's applications for agriculture as well.
Yes, there is. So I actually think of CRISPRs as being the fancy new scissors that are available that are cheap and easy to use. But there are other technologies, like George was mentioning, that have been around for years that can actually do similar things that CRISPRs can do. They can make cuts in DNA in a very targeted manner. So CRISPRs is just a fancy new kid on the block, if you will, in the genetic toolbox that we can use. But there are other technologies that have enabled this revolution, if you will, such as DNA sequencing. We can do it faster, much more inexpensively. As well as in plants, you can take single cells that have been edited and regenerate them into entirely new plants. So all of these other technologies have really pushed and made it more of a gene editing technology instead of a CRISPR revolution.
So gene editing, as such, isn't new. It's the ease of being able to do that?
Yes, it's the fancy new way of doing it.
Gotcha. And Ben, your take.
Yeah, no, I think that's absolutely right. So as somebody who works on a mosquito, Aedes aegypti, which has not traditionally been tractable in terms of studying the genetics in that organism, CRISPR is sort of the latest genome editing tool that allows us to scan through dozens of genes at once rather than one or two with previous technologies. And so rather than turning to something like a fruit fly, which is what we would have done in the past to understand the genetics in a non-model organism, now we can do those studies directly in the animal that we care about and that has biomedical relevance.
And Josie, excited, frightened, a little of both?
No, I think a little bit building on what George said is that this particular technology, I think, makes real and can be a sort of a point to discuss a range of technologies in genetics, including sequencing technologies, and really makes vivid some of the things that have really been fantasy and this sort of substance of science fiction before sort of seem like they might be closer. And so we have, you know, we don't know. We have to see how far we get towards some of those sort of futuristic scenarios. But this definitely has ignited interest and made some of those things like modifications in humans seem closer, and therefore puts an urgency and a kind of brings alive a kind of conversation that we probably need to have.
Yeah, excellent. So what I want to do at the top of this is go through some of the applications for CRISPR. We have people here from very different backgrounds who are looking to use CRISPR as a tool for many different things. And then after that, I want to explore some of the ethical challenges that may be there in trying to apply this in an appropriate fashion. So Luke, let's start with the work that you're doing. You're a cancer researcher. You've been doing pioneering work in creating animal models of disease using CRISPR. Tell us a little bit about how you are using CRISPR, and in particular the work you've done in mice with tumors.
Yeah, so the mouse has been the backbone of genetic research, I would say, for decades, at least the last 30 years when we've really been able to manipulate the genome and study genetic effects. So our goal and our mission really is to try and create mouse models of cancer that mimic the precise mutations that happen in human cancer, with the ultimate goal of producing a model system that we can use for preclinical studies and develop therapeutics and move towards the clinic for treating patients with those same cancers with those same mutations. So maybe I should step back and say that initial introduction may have seemed like we were all playing down the impact of CRISPR and taking a step back, and I think that's important. It's not the only thing, it's not the only kid on the block. But in practical terms, it really has changed the way we do research in the lab. And so, you know, take one example. It's we have chromosomes made up of genes, and we often have mutations in these genes, but sometimes we have huge segments of these chromosomes that are deleted or that flip around, and these create fusions and therapeutically targetable genes. These have been very, very difficult to study in a mouse model. Now, with CRISPR, we can actually engineer them by creating two cuts, and at some frequency, the chromosome will flip, and creates exactly the same lesion that we would see in a human cancer. And we just hadn't thought really pursuing those studies. It was doable, but just not practical. And so now we can do it. We've spent the last year building these rearrangements, and it's actually told us a lot about the initiation of tumors in the colon.
And have you actually been able to reverse a cancer in a mouse?
We have, but actually that may be a different topic. It wasn't using CRISPR. no, I mean, this is an important point, and it gets back to, you know, there was a predecessor technologies that led up to this, and multiple ways to manipulate genes. And the way we did that one was to take a gene that's mutated in 9 out of 10 colorectal cancers, and we think it's one of the drivers of the disease. We used a tool called short hairpin RNAs, or shRNAs, where we can suppress that gene specifically. The mice develop tumors, get aggressive disease, and then we can turn the gene back on. And what we saw was that within 2 weeks, all the cancers had disappeared. And so we're following that up, trying to mimic that effect therapeutically. And to do that, we're using CRISPRs to build the models and using shRNAs to mimic the therapies. So in that sense, we're really combining all of the best tools we have to create our ultimate dream model.
And how does this relate then to colon cancer in humans? Can you take what you're learning there, and will it work in people?
So we can't go in and turn genes on and off as easily as we can in the mouse, because we engineer them specifically for that purpose. But we can understand the pathways that go awry, and then we can design drugs or other targeted therapies that can come in and intervene in those pathways. So that's really the ultimate goal, understand the genetics, and then figure out a way to apply it with a drug.
So editing DNA is just one of the things that CRISPR is being used for. But other researchers are using it in different ways to study cell development and disease. And Harry, I'd like to turn to you and your work. How do you use CRISPR to understand genetic risk for disease?
Right. So you may recall that we had a famous lawsuit that was settled on gene patenting in 2013. And up until that time, the BRCA1 and 2 genes, which when mutated, you know, increase a woman's risk for developing breast and ovarian cancer, you know, also have an effect for men as well. And there was one company that was offering testing, and they had their own catalog of variants that they had curated over their 20-year history. So it wasn't really available to the public. And as a result of that case, you know, BRCA1 and 2 and other genes are no longer patented. But we still have the problem of dealing with this issue of knowing what genetic variant is going to increase risk, you know, what genetic variant is going to have no effect whatsoever. Well, we can mimic these mutations by, or we can mimic these variants in cells, and then we can look to see, well, is there a pattern that is being expressed by these cells that we see in the individuals who are at increased risk for breast cancer? This leads, for instance, to the development of what's called CRISPR libraries, where we can create quite large catalogs of these variants, put them into cells, and then identify those cells through genomic sequencing, you know, that have these patterns that one would observe in people who have this increased risk for breast and ovarian cancer.
And why couldn't you do this before CRISPR? What did CRISPR allow you to do?
It's an incredibly efficient technology. You know, so, you know, as the other panelists have said, there have been other methods along the way, and the whole issue with regard to doing targeted engineering of the genome has certainly existed since the late 1970s and early 1980s, when genetic engineering really became a possibility as a result of recombinant DNA. But what you're hearing now is not recombinant DNA, you're hearing gene editing. It's conceptually somewhat different thing. It's not really putting in something new, it's changing what's already there, but it's changing what's already there in many different ways in many different cells, and then sorting out the patterns that are occurring in these cells to predict what they might be doing.
And at what point does it reach a clinical application that you can say to someone, you've got this variant and that does this to your risk?
Well, I think it can be used every day now, and I think
already it's being
I think it can be used, for prediction of breast cancer. I think in this gene APC that Lucas studies, we now have the possibility of introducing those variants as well, and really sorting out the variants of uncertain significance from the ones that are the pathogenic mutations that increase someone's risk for developing colon cancer.
Ben, I want to pull you in on a topic near and dear to my heart, mosquitoes. So much of the conversation about CRISPR has revolved around the potential for treating disease or editing genes in human embryos, something we're gonna discuss. But researchers say the real revolution right now is in the lab. And you're a bench scientist. You've been working with mosquitoes. Tell us what you do and how CRISPR is involved in that.
Sure, absolutely. So, as you said, I work directly on mosquitoes, which previously have not been really a genetic model, meaning that we can't edit and engineer their genomes directly until the advent of tools like zinc finger nucleases and TALENs, and now CRISPR. And so what CRISPR lets us do is actually mutate genes in the mosquito that we think are responsible for their system of smell and taste. And so what we are interested in specifically is figuring out how a mosquito in its environment will find you, for example, and take a blood meal. And so what you're looking at up here is a female Aedes aegypti mosquito. And so she is the vector for a number of arboviruses, including Zika virus, which is a big problem these days, and some that have been around a little bit longer, like dengue fever, yellow fever, and chikungunya. And so a female mosquito is exquisitely tuned to find and bite human beings. And females do this because they need to develop eggs. So that blood meal that you see her taking right there is going to about double her body weight. And so she is going to drink about 2 milligrams of blood, and then she's going to turn that into a batch of 100 mosquitoes. And so this is why evolution has really acted on their sense of smell and taste. And so what we do with CRISPR, and this slide is just kind of schematizing how we do it. So we have taken these components that George and others figured out in bacteria are responsible for cutting DNA at specific places, and we re-engineer them in the lab and then re-inject them back into mosquito embryos. And we do this not to make that embryo mutant, but we do it so that we can mutate a sperm or an egg in that embryo, which is going to give rise to a stable mosquito mutant, in essence. So it's a mosquito that either is missing a certain gene, or we've engineered a certain mutation in a gene, or what we're doing now, which we're really excited about, is actually introducing new sequence into, so this would be the analogy of the paste of your word processor, to harken back to the video. And so what we can do now is we can get genes that we want to express in cells that we want to have those genes expressed in, and we can get control over neural circuits. We can image the brain of the mosquito as it's hunting for a host in the environment. And so these are things that we could have dreamed of 5 years ago, and our colleagues in the fruit fly have been doing for decades, but that's because they had 100 years of genetic history to work from. And in the last 3, 4, 5 years since the advent of CRISPR, we've been able to catch up in a lot of ways and now ask questions about blood feeding that we can't ask in a fruit fly. And so this is showing you just what happens when we put in a sequence of DNA in a particular locus. So you have a blue and a red mutant strain of mosquitoes. Each one of them is missing a gene that we think is involved in their ability to find an appropriate place to lay eggs. And what we've done is we've actually replaced that gene with a ubiquitous fluorescent reporter, so either a blue or a red protein that we can see under a microscope. And so we do this so that we can follow them in the lab, and then we assess their behavior with really sensitive behavioral assays to identify which of these genes are involved in the critical behaviors for the mosquito's life cycle and disease transmission. And so this has really been the result of the last 2 or 3 years. We've come much, much further than we had in the previous 5 or 10, specifically because of the advent of CRISPR. And so my experience with people who work on other non-model organisms is that if you can figure out how to get these reagents into an embryo, CRISPR will work. It will make its cut. And that didn't have to be the case. And so that's one of the most amazing things to me at least, is that something that's so evolutionarily ancient will work in human cells or mouse cells or mosquito cells. And so what we do, and this is my hand, so we're not going to release these anytime soon into the environment, but you can imagine that by generating certain strains of mutant mosquitoes that may be poor at targeting human beings or have other altered behaviors, that we can understand the processes that they use to find and bite people and by proxy transmit disease.
So you create a mosquito that no longer finds people tasty.
That's one idea, yeah. And if we do that, then we have a handle on what the genes or families of genes that they use to do that. And you can start thinking about developing a repellent, for example. So we have things like DEET right now, but we still don't understand how DEET works. And so we would like to be able to know what are the genes that they use to find humans, and then we can start thinking about how to interfere with them, similar to how in cancer you need to know what the genetic basis of a cancer is before you can think about treating it genetically.
George, you got a lot of the CRISPR ball rolling, and you stunned the science world when you demonstrated that you could modify 60 genes at once in a pig. Who cares about modifying 60 genes in a pig?
Well, we didn't set out to set a record. I mean, we were already, all of us were pretty excited about being able to change one or two with great ease, or make a library where you're doing one at a time, but hundreds of thousands of them in the library, each separate. But in the case of the pig, there was a promise, a wish, for about two decades to be able to transplant organs from pigs into humans to solve, you know, one of the most severe crises in medicine, which is this unavailability of a sufficient number of organs for transplant. There was about $1 billion invested in it about 15 years ago, and it kind of came crashing down. It was a pretty good roadmap even for using the old tools that we had that we've been alluding to, but it came to a crashing halt because it was discovered that there were viruses built into every cell of the pig that, when in an immune-compromised patient, could escape from the pig's organ, the donor that was going to save the life of the recipient, but these viruses would get out and then infect this immune-compromised patient. So it became kind of a perfect storm incubator for the next really bad virus. So we didn't want to create the next Ebola or HIV or swine flu. And so there was a moratorium on that research for about 15 years. CRISPR came along and we thought, oh, we can do one or two pretty easily. Let's try 62. And actually, we were quite concerned that it wouldn't work, but it certainly wouldn't work if we didn't try it. So we tried it, and after 14 days, and this is not 14 days of hard labor, this is 14 days of it sitting in the incubator, right. We came back, and all 62 of these retroviral genes that were in the pig genome were dead. And we showed that there were no infectious virus being spread anymore. So this released, it showed the great promise for now doing all the things we need to do to make pig organs acceptable for humans.
So a direct practical application where this may provide organs for people.
That's right, yeah, millions of people, right.
Noel,
yes.
Let's talk plants.
Okay.
Potential applications of genome editing for global agriculture are huge. Can you talk a little bit about what the problem is there and what it is you're trying to address and how CRISPR feeds into that?
Oh, certainly. So it has been predicted that by the year 2050, there'll be over 9 billion people on Earth. That's a lot of people, and that's a lot of people that are going to be hungry. So what are we going to do to feed them? Well, one of the solutions would be to make agricultural acres that we typically grow plants on a lot more productive. But another solution to this problem was to be able to grow plants in environments that are unfavorable, that we typically don't grow plants on. For example, in environments where there's very little water or there's very little nutrients in the soil. Well, now we can develop plants that actually are drought resistant, so they can grow in areas where there's very little water. We can develop plants actually that have sustainability traits in which they are actually more efficient or very much more effectively utilize nutrients in the soil, such as fertilizers. So we can actually do that. And so one of the real world problems that we face right now is in developing countries. So what I'd like to draw your attention to is cereal yields over time. And what you can see clearly is that in Africa, cereal yields have been stagnant, whereas in other areas of the world, they have increased. So why is that? So besides the reason for lack of infrastructure, some of the reasons why it's been stagnant is because they use very little or no fertilizers, and there's no irrigation. So we can actually develop plants that these farmers or growers in developing countries can use to feed themselves, that can feed their families, and also their surrounding communities. So it's a very exciting time.
You know, one of the topics that's been in the news a lot and concerns and debates has to do with genetically modified organisms and things that people are going to be eating. What you're doing here in these plants, mm-hmm. is that genetically modified organisms as that is typically defined?
So let me tell you how we do things a little bit differently than others in the plant field at CBIS. So up here you can see is a slide that we like to use as an analogy. So what we do at CBIS is actually, if you were to change one letter or two letters in one word in the entire Sunday edition of the New York Times, you would actually change the sentence. So for example, if you had the word cat and you change the C to a T, now you have, I'm going to bring home a new cat, to now I'm going to have a new tat. And so you have actually have changed the meaning of that particular sentence. So what we do in plant gene editing at CBIS is we actually will change one or a few nucleotides or letters of a genetic code in a gene in a very targeted manner, and this will actually give us a trait or a phenotype that we actually desire to have. So some of these traits are, for example, drought resistance, which I've already talked about. So plants are able to grow with using very little water. In the next slide, we show corn. So you can make drought-resistant corn. And so what our technology actually does is we actually provide instructions that are delivered to single cells of plants along with another gene editing tool, for example, CRISPRs, but it can be other tools as well. And we actually, these instructions do is it tells the cell, the plant cell, to make changes in a very targeted way to genes within the cell. So it actually changes its own DNA. Then once it actually does this, our instructions are degraded through natural cellular processes. So it's a little bit different than what others have done in this field. And so some of the products that we have coming out, which is already in the market, is canola. We also have a product coming out in flax, and future products consist of potato as well as rice.
Josie, what's your take? Are we splitting hairs to not think of this as genetic modification, or is it different in that there's no foreign microbes DNA being inserted? Does this get around some of those issues ethically?
That with the plant in plants?
Yeah.
So, it is genetic modification. I don't think that it's genetic modification. I don't think that's necessarily in dispute. And you would have an organism that was modified, as in its genes were different than they would have been if you hadn't done this. There is a difference between introducing foreign DNA into something versus making a change in the DNA that already exists. And people have to think about how significant is that difference. And certainly regulators have to think about that difference, whether that makes something, where that something falls on a regulatory line in that way. It is important to think about the genetically modified foods debate and how that has transpired. And then this is, another step in that. It's not exactly the same, but it's also, part of the same kind of activity. really.
We will definitely get into some of the regulatory issues as well as some of the public discussion of how you bring the public along as these new technologies come into play. But George, a leading CRISPR food researcher has said that if you've eaten yogurt or cheese, chances are you've eaten CRISPRized cells.
That's true. Dairy products have a problem with viruses that get in and kill the bacteria that are making changing it from a regular raw milk into something tasty with distinctive tastes. So if the viruses kill the bacteria, then you get bad yogurt and cheese. And so the companies that make yogurt and cheese have harnessed natural bacterial defenses against these, and this was one of the first applications of CRISPR back in the mid-2000s. So I think it's very exciting. Everybody should be very excited that they participated in the CRISPR revolution in 2007. Dan and yogurt, you know.
So a question about that then is CRISPR something that was invented or something that was discovered?
Well, it's a little of each. Almost every major invention involves some basic scientific discovery. It is not at all obvious that just because you've made a discovery, it's going to turn into an invention. There are many, many discoveries that take forever or a long time to or never become an invention. And some of these things that many of these molecular technologies come originally from microorganisms, but some of them are still in microorganisms. So, for example, we have a competing another technology that we're using that only works in E. coli K12, called MAGE or beta. And I think eventually it will escape, but we've been working on it much longer than CRISPR, and then we happened to try CRISPR, and it worked almost first time.
So maybe one thing just to follow up, what George was alluding to, is that it actually, the parts that are involved in CRISPR are part of a bacterial innate immunity or a defense system in those bacteria. So they existed, but it took a suite of very smart people to figure out how to adapt that and make it useful for us. So it's been around, and it's in this room right now.
It's something that bacteria have always used.
Yeah, maybe another way of saying it is the bacteria use it to kill viruses. We use it to edit genes. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's a very different thing. It's not just a discovery. Right. That's the difference.
Yeah. Right. Ben, I'm hoping you can help explain another concept to further discussion. But one of the fascinating aspects of the new science relates to something called a gene drive.
Sure.
So what is that, and how do gene drives and CRISPRs all relate?
Yeah, so a gene drive is sort of CRISPR that's been harnessed to another level in that you actually take the components that make up the CRISPR system, and you insert those into the genome of, for example, a yeast or a mosquito, and there have been people who have done this in the mosquito. And the idea there is that you have now kind of vectorized, which is a word that means you've turned that animal into a vector for the CRISPR system, and if you were to release that into the environment, it would conceivably edit its own genome, and then it would drive that genetic package into its offspring in a way that kind of breaks the normal rules of inheritance. So you're basically adding a genetic weapon, if you will, to a mosquito or to a yeast or to another animal, so that when it's released in the environment, it will target the endogenous genome in a way that will copy that weapon and so on and so forth. So it will actually drive itself into the population of wild animals that will mate with the animal that you release. So,
and some of the papers I've been looking at talk about that as a way to possibly wiping out mosquitoes that spread malaria.
Yep. So there are a lot of attractive kind of aspects of this, in that, you know, if you think about trying to eradicate the malaria mosquito, for example, you could drop a ton of insecticide everywhere where that mosquito is, but that's going to be extremely nonspecific. That's going to get the malaria mosquito, it's going to get all the other species of mosquitoes, and all of the other insects, in addition to whatever else those drugs may target. So the one of the really attractive parts to this is that it should be species specific, assuming that you don't have something called horizontal gene transfer where it will jump from one species to another. And that's one of the big issues that people talk about when they urge caution in rushing these out into the field. So it's specific, and you should be able to use it to engineer those animals to have a specific trait. So you could either kill them, or you could render them immune to the types of viruses that mosquitoes spread. So if there are Aedes aegypti out there, but they're incapable of spreading Zika, now they're a nuisance rather than a killer. And so you could potentially use these gene drives to change the phenotype of animals in the environment with this type of tool.
George, you argue that if you're going to do something like this, there should be an off switch. How do you do an off switch? Sounds like it, once you let this out into the world, it's going to take off.
Yeah. So for many of the technologies we develop, that there are concern. We raise concerns, and we did that in this case before we did any experiments. We wanted to have a way of reversing it in case somebody did it without permission or did it with permission, but it didn't work as well as we thought. Every technology needs to be reversible. And the way you do it in this case is you use the gene drive, another gene drive against the first one. So basically you drive through the population first time through where you recode the target. So the CRISPR will only cut the normal version and won't cut the gene that you're targeting in its new form. Then the reversal just goes and says, oh, I'm only looking at the new form, I'm not looking at the old form, and so then you can get it back to where it was. And this, and we've tested this in one species so far that I know of, and it's very important to test it in multiple species, just like it's important to test that we don't see horizontal transfer, right. And you need to scale these things up to pretty large scale to make sure that it works at scale.
So given how new a lot of these technologies are, and the concept sounds wonderful, how do you assure that there won't be untoward effects, things that hadn't been thought of, some downstream, or how big do you have to scale it up to be comfortable saying, okay, we're going to release this in 10 countries?
Yeah, so There are entire villages that artificial villages that are contained within domes where the entire village is a physical containment. There are also ways that you put a biological containment on top of that. But I think you do have to do it. You start out with something small, as you know, a small laboratory-sized experiment, and then you go to these artificial villages where you simulate the crops and the animals and the multiple species of mosquito and the rain and all that.
So Josie, malaria kills more than 500,000 people every year, mainly children. And it looks like it may soon, in the not too distant future, be possible to wipe out off the face of the earth the mosquito that transmits the infection. How is it ethical to not take the step to eliminate that mosquito?
It seems to me that if it were all the things that George was just saying, if it were safe, if it could be reversed if necessary, if it was not going to do these unpredictable horizontal things, if we knew that in a complex environment, which is what our environments are, that it would function the way that we hope, then we would have, you know, it could be a slam dunk in favor. And so these are really significant questions, safety questions, really, that must be resolved. Yeah. And when you have such a significant benefit, then there's a lot of incentive to really try to work on those and make sure that they are resolved. But we, you know, you don't have to look very far into human history to see examples of changing environments introducing species that then take over or that do unpredictable things. So we don't want to make those same kinds of mistakes again. And so a lot of the effort and a lot of the coordination and oversight and international bodies looking at these things are trying to figure out exactly how to achieve the dream without having any disastrous effects on environments or these kinds of unpredictable sideways leaps that we wouldn't want to happen.
This is the Jurassic Park effect. I mean, maybe I was conditioned because I was 12 or 13 when Jurassic Park came out.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's a lot of parallels there. That's not what's happening. I mean, mosquitoes versus... But, you know, it sort of worries me a little bit because it's very unpredictable. We can do a lot of tests, and you do have to go to scale to try and do these things. But then at some point, there is a tipping point where it's the potential benefit outweighs that, and there's no right answer, and there's no line where you can say, okay, we've finally crossed it. Just as a wealth of knowledge comes, and you say, all right, we have to pull the trigger.
Ben, you want to get in on it?
Yeah, I was just going to say that for every case, there are going to be unique considerations as well. And so for malaria in particular, it's more than one species of mosquito. And so now you're looking at potentially editing Anopheles gambi, Anopheles defensi, and maybe a dozen other species as well, depending on where in the world you are. And there are different strains of these mosquitoes in different geographical locations. So you may have to think about building different gene drives for Africa than you would for India or other parts of the world. And so it's... Every case of this is going to be kind of laden with complexity, which does not mean that we shouldn't be pursuing this research, but it does mean that we're probably a ways off from actually implementing it at scale.
It's kind of the beauty of engineering mindset, the way of thinking that comes with engineering meets the complexity of biology, yeah. And being very careful about that intersection.
All right, well, I'm going to up the level of concern in just a second, but I wanted to latch onto what you said, Luke, about the Jurassic Park effect, because the gentleman sitting next to you has talked about creating a woolly mammoth. So the first question is, can you do it? And the second question is, did you see the movie?
We picked the herbivore.
Thank you.
We should have had Jeff Goldblum on this panel.
Life finds a way.
Yeah.
Would the third question maybe be, would it be a woolly mammoth actually? Mm. Or would it be a modified version of it, something with some traits of woolly mammoth? But
I think if we get sufficiently compulsive, which scientists tend to do, we would eventually asymptotically approach it. But probably many people would be quite satisfied once we had a cold-resistant elephant that's comfortable at minus 40 and looks like a woolly mammoth.
I don't know if a lot of people would use the word satisfied. Yeah.
I mean, and then saving the tundra and saving the Asian elephant germline and various other positive things, I think that would probably be a milestone that we should celebrate. But yeah, then the compulsive folks will get in there and change every single base pair and figure out every epigenetic change and what it eats and all the rest of that stuff. But I think there'll be a great deal to celebrate if we get even to a cold-resistant Asian elephant.
So I want to move away from mosquitoes and plants and woolly mammoths to one area where there's probably been the most debate and concern, and that's whether... if ever, we would want to use this technique to edit the human germline and change human inheritance, affecting generation after generation of unborn children by changing everything from eye color to IQ to inherited diseases. You know, all these changes would be carried in all cells and passed on to subsequent generations. But let's talk a little bit about the science of how that could happen. And Harry, Can you explain a little bit about what it means to edit a germline versus edit a cancer cell in an adult?
Well, you know, we heard some of that already with regard to mosquitoes and, you know, getting it into the germline. The same sort of principles apply. The editing is done early in an embryo before there is so-called segregation of the germ cells, and so cells will divide, cells will differentiate into lineages, including the germline, and of course the issue, or one of the issues that tends to concern people is what are the long-term consequences? The issue with gene editing focuses always on the degree of specificity. And
what do you mean by degrees of specificity?
Right. So it's made out to be a magic set of scissors that always works. It's like going to a master tailor, who is able to make a specific correction. But in order to insert exactly the sequence that you want, requires that a set of enzymes that are present in the cell, are doing their jobs and doing it efficiently, so that a cut is being made, as you heard, but then it's being repaired. It may be repaired in the way that you want it to be repaired, or it may be repaired in some, in some other way. There's also the possibility that a cut is being made someplace else in the genome, and unless you look for it, you might be missing it. And this refers to the so-called off-target effects that might be occurring with gene editing. For those reasons, I think this panel probably would see it principally, as a research tool right now, rather than a specific therapeutic tool for humans. But as so often happens with medical research, we have been down this path before with regard to gene therapies. Take the term gene therapies and use Ben's paste. And put editing in the middle, then voila, here we are right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If we had the ability to edit out heritable diseases or to make people more resistant to infectious diseases, would there be a problem with going that route?
So it really depends upon when this is being done in the life cycle and whether it is meant to edit the germline versus, editing the so-called somatic cells. For instance, now, with the use of gene therapies, not specifically gene editing therapies, it's possible to engineer retinal cells and cause them to produce photopigments or other proteins that may be deficient within these photoreceptor or other retinal cells, and for people who are blind, they're now able to see. So it's been, quite miraculous, frankly.
Josie, is human germline editing something that we should ever permit? Do you see a way that would be permissible ethically?
So the question is a good one, insofar as there are people who have an in principle objection to making changes in the human genome that are permanent, that would be passed on. And they would only be in favor of some of these, what we're talking about, somatic treatments, where a child or an adult has a particular problem, and there might be something you can do, but that wouldn't be inherited. And there are people who draw a line in the sand there and say that's a line we should never cross. And certainly that's why there was a large international meeting in, recently to talk about this very question. And I'm not one of those people, so I don't think that there is an in principle line in the sand that we shouldn't cross. But I think for some of the same reasons that we're cautious, we'll be very cautious about introducing changes into ecosystems. We're an ecosystem, and so I would want to be very, very, very sure about the safety of any change that we were going to put in place that would be heritable, and that we'd understand how that change was going to work. Now, when we think about the kinds of reasons, what would be a good reason to try to make a heritable change, it's not hard to come up with devastating conditions that we would think, if we could not have Huntington's disease being passed on in families, some people might think, that would be an obvious thing that would be a good. It just gets very complicated when you start thinking about complex traits. So we don't know enough. We don't know anything like enough about what most of our genes do, and we certainly don't know what affects a lot of our traits. So the idea of being able to increase intelligence or being able to control anything related to personality or even things like complex diseases like obesity or cancers, we wouldn't know how to do it, what to do, even if we had that opportunity to do it right now. So I do think there's a complex, difficult discussion that we're going to have about germline modification, because I don't think we're going to be able to justify an in principle a ban on that. Once it's proven to be safe in particular ways, we're going to have a conversation about what the limits are for how we would use that technology. There are still people who would, you know, see that as a line in the sand that we should never cross. But my belief is that we will and should cross it in some cases, and the hard work is going to be justifying those cases and understanding when and agreeing, really, because it's going to be hard to agree whether there are any limits to that.
George, who would you see getting to decide what's an improvement of the human genome and what should be allowed to go forward?
Well, I mean, I think the interesting case is how we get from here to there. I agree with what you just said, that we're probably going to go there, and what's the transition state? And I think that one will be that when you have two parents that are carriers for a serious disease, the only options they have today are to adopt children or to do abortion or to do in vitro fertilization, which many people consider a form of abortion because you froze the embryos without resuscitating them. So an alternative would be to alter the sperm so that at least one of the parents is no longer a carrier in the germline sense, and that would put no embryos at risk and would appeal to people who consider embryos a form of human life. That is a possible transition zone that we could have, or the process of curing infertility would be another one. But then I think your question is, where do we stop? And I think the way the experience of most medicine has been that if it's safe and effective, it doesn't necessarily have to be life and death. So if you look through all the drugs that have been approved by the FDA, only a tiny fraction of them deal with life and death. A lot of them have to do with headaches and, athlete's foot and, a whole variety of things that are not that serious. Facial reconstruction is serious after an accident, but most cosmetic surgery is not that serious. In fact, sometimes it's contraindicated because people are already pretty good looking.
There does become an issue of personal choice as well. We did a survey about 10 years ago in our patients who came to see us at NYU for genetic counseling. And we asked people, what did you want genetic testing for? And what would you want to do embryo selection for? And basically the answer was, everything. And this was before the era of easy gene editing that we have now. But about 10 to 12% of these reproductive age people said that if there were a test that would be predictive of superior intelligence or superior athletic ability in their children, well, they would want to have it. And as we've seen, for instance, with consumer genetics, that people won't be denied in terms of the types of information that they'd like to be able to achieve. But certainly a topic that has emerged from this panel is that scientific progress occurs sequentially, and there is always the anticipation that a series of milestones are going to be met in order to get from here to there. I hope you're going to get into the issue, though, of terrorism, because
I do want to hit that, but I want to reflect back on a comment that Jennifer Doudna made at the beginning, that she feels a responsibility as a researcher to educate people and to listen to their concerns. And she says that one of her biggest fears would be waking up one morning and reading about the first CRISPR baby, and having that create a major public backlash where people ban the use of CRISPR or regulators shut down CRISPR research, and that she thinks that could be very detrimental to the field. What are your thoughts on that?
But what does that mean? You were talking about genetically modified organisms earlier, and the European Union is, you know, notoriously opposed to a genetic modification. You know, I don't think that the issue is one of safety or efficacy for human health with regard to genetically modified organisms. I think it's one of economic hegemony from American seed producers that, you know, Europeans don't want to be, you know, under the heel of Monsanto. What extent there's going to be economic domination by virtue of having, you know, access to these technologies with patent protections becomes a very important issue.
George?
I think that as far as I know, the Europeans are not opposed to genetically modified insulin. It's produced in bacteria.
Correct.
It's used for serious diabetes.
Yeah.
So there is a line between major health issues and, you know, quite frankly, genetically modified foods do not have obvious taste, even economic benefits to the average grocery store shopper. So I think that that's what's happening there. And when you get back to your question about Jennifer's fear that the first CRISPR baby, I think back to the first in vitro fertilization baby. I don't think that the people that invented that were upset when Elizabeth Brown was born. They were delighted that finally there was a solution for infertile couples, and Elizabeth Brown was a very healthy baby. So the important thing about that breakthrough, there was a lot of worry up front. They were dismissed and demonized as test tube babies that were going to be horrible, monstrous babies, but it wasn't. And so the difference was Elizabeth Bourne was born healthy. So if Jennifer reads about the first healthy CRISPR baby that's cute and cuddly and isn't diseased, she probably will be proud of it.
The international group that I think, Josie, you were referring to called for a moratorium on making inheritable changes to the human genome. It said it would be irresponsible to proceed until the risks could be better assessed and until there was a broad societal consensus about the appropriateness of any proposed change. And in that opening conference, I quoted David Baltimore earlier, but he also said the overriding question is when, if ever, we will want to use gene editing to change human inheritance. And the question I have is who gets to make the decision? And in terms of where that line is, and how do you go from, where's that line between getting rid of Huntington's disease and, in a sense, eugenics, where you are selecting for a baby that you see in the catalog who's got the genes that you want to see?
So in a way, we kind of have some of these questions already playing out now insofar as different countries have different approaches to the regulation of pre-implantation genetic diagnosis and prenatal testing, which are two ways not to edit genes, but to influence what the genetic makeup of children is, because those with particular genetic markers won't be selected, so they won't be born, essentially. And so what you see is that there's no one person deciding. There are different countries with different approaches, and in England they have law on this, and they have a regulatory authority, and they have a very comprehensive system of oversight and governance. And in the United States, there are professional guidelines, but there's no national law on this here. So you have very different, and then in other countries also, again, different approaches. There's not one oversight system. And so now that, you know, internet research is so international, and there's absolutely no direct way of controlling what a researcher in a particular country that isn't strictly regulating these issues might do. And so there's no way that we can guarantee Jennifer that she won't wake up and see that story, and it might be done really well and have a really good outcome, or it might not, and it's not as if there's anyone who is ultimately in control. It's really going to be up to individual scientists. And at the end of the day, probably up to individual prospective parents to decide, you know, when things are available. And so you see now, you know, really wonderful uses of in vitro fertilization technology to help people overcome fertility or to help them to make choices about the kinds of, you know, inheritable diseases that will continue in their families. But you also see people using the technology to not have a baby girl or not have a baby boy. And there's no, and in some countries that's regulated, and in America it isn't. And so there's no guarantee that you won't have those kinds of other uses of gene editing technology as well.
But pre-implantation genetic diagnosis isn't an intervention, and once there's an intervention, then the Food and Drug Administration, you know, is going to argue that this is a, you know, new procedure that would, you know, require meeting their standards, I would think.
But they have standards for safety and efficacy. The standards are not about ethical acceptability or moral issues. And
so I
do think that, you know, it's not crazy for us at all to be having a conversation about the scene in Gattaca where the couple goes in and the geneticist has made the various modifications to their embryos, and they say to him, well, we kind of thought we might leave some things to chance because they were kind of trying to have something resembling an old-fashioned parenting experience. That's the kind of decision-making, you know, that we may have to engage in the future. Like, what kind of, how much control do we as parents or prospective parents want to have over who will be born? And some people will say, I would like to control everything, I'd like to know about everything. And some people will say, no, I don't want to be that kind of person, that kind of parent that gets to decide all these things. And you know, one of my concerns is just that the kind of consumer mindset and the sort of competitive nature of society will push people to use technologies, PGD, prenatal testing, and gene editing in ways that are inconsistent with their values because they feel like that's the only way to succeed in this world.
I'm having what's known as moderator anxiety because I'm looking at the countdown clock and I promised that I would hit some questions from Twitter, and I also have a number of topics that I want to get to. So I'm going to hit a couple questions from Twitter, and then there are a couple other topics I really want to get to.
Can we maybe do a little editing for you to help you overcome your
anxiety? Yeah, see? Yeah. I don't know if it'll happen fast enough, but here we go. Okay, so I'll combine a couple here in the topic that you'd asked for. This comes from Twitter from JLabGuy, who wants to know, how do we regulate CRISPR used in militarized applications? For example, super soldiers and bioweapons. And then another question from McSween. Dr. Matthews brought up CRISPR as a weapon. That worries me. Would it be possible for someone to delete the off switch? In the introduction, one of the things that you heard was I spent a lot of years at CDC working on bioterrorism and emergency preparedness. And when I hear CRISPR, it's one of those things that worries me in terms of the things that people who might not want to do good could potentially do. How do you, and anyone can jump in on this, how do you take this technology that can, it sounds like, do incredible things and prevent it from being used for harm, deliberate harm?
I mean, you can't. People will do what they will do.
Yeah.
But what we're talking about here in very general terms is, okay, we make a super soldier. Not one person on this panel or anywhere in the world knows how to go in and manipulate which genes to create a super soldier. Even if we did, the traits that you would give a super soldier, maybe like increased healing or something like that, would actually probably predispose them to get more cancer. And so this comes back to how we get into this field of germline editing. Might be there's a horrible disease that we want to fix, and that's fine. And it works, but what works for gene A is not necessarily going to work for gene B, C, 20,000. So just because it works once doesn't mean it's going to work a second time. And even if it did work, there's no off-target effects and everything was very clean. Throughout the 80-year lifespan of a human, we have no idea what that modification might do if it doesn't already exist in the population and we can understand it.
So let's throw away the super soldier. What about a super microorganism?
Well, there's a shorter timeline for testing those things, but how do you regulate that? I mean, I don't think there's an answer.
You can regulate against it, but you might not be able to prevent it.
Yeah. One thing I'd like to comment on is that in human gene editing, they're still working out how to deliver this effectively to targeted tissue. So they're still in, you know, this mode of trying to figure that out. They're a long ways away from actually being able to make mutant armies, if you will. That can conquer the world. So, I mean, scientists are still working out how to deliver them in a targeted way in the field.
But the more immediate issue is the one that you faced at CDC, which is creating superbugs, which is a more tractable issue than creating a super soldier. And it's vigilance, it's monitoring, whose hands the reagents fall into. It's a lot of things.
All right, we're going to need to go through some more little rapid topics. But George, I didn't want to let the evening go without hitting the headlines that you made yesterday when you, with your article in Science, talking about the Human Genome Project, right? You called for a huge publicly and privately funded project to construct large plant and animal genomes, including humans, from scratch. And what is it that intrigues you about this? What do you see as the promise of this big project? And how does it relate, if at all, to CRISPR?
Right. So, this is a committee effort. My particular part of it is to take a big project and turn it into a little project. That is to say, to bring down the costs and improve the effectiveness, as has happened with DNA sequencing, which used to be $3 billion, is now $1,000, and has happened with CRISPR and other synthesis things. So the idea would be to bring all it radically down so you can test hypotheses. You can figure out what's cause and effect in human diseases. You can make, we've already made a multivirus resistant organism by changing the genetic code of every gene in the whole genome. You could do that. You can do that for bacteria. Doing it in mammalian cells would be somewhere between 5 and 1,000 times harder. But it has significant advantages, both for basic science, but also there have been cases where a virus infection has wiped out a pharmaceutical factory for 2 years. So if you could make the cells they use for manufacturing the human proteins resistant to viruses, that would be a big deal. And there are many other examples like that where just improving the technology would open up whole new possibilities like that.
So this is a project on even a grander scale than the sequencing of the human genome.
I don't think it's important to say whether it's grand or not. I mean, what I would like to do is make it less grand, to make it something that's ordinary.
Bite-sized pieces that can be done. The ethics of doing this. In your paper, you brought up those issues.
Yes. So I mean, I think all these technologies are so enabling and so exponentially growing that we need to bring up ethics constantly. In this particular case, the projects would be limited to cell lines, to testing hypotheses, as we've heard earlier, in cell lines or organoids, where you it would not be for producing whole organisms necessarily, but there would be related projects which would have even more ethical issues, where you make whole animals, which would have ethics of abuse of animals, or making humans, which we've already talked about, that germline issue.
Harry, legal experts have warned that there's not even a modicum of regulatory clarity when it comes to government agencies and CRISPR and its applications. You have some experience in terms of regulatory work. What kind of path do you see towards regulation here in the U.S. and then more in the international context?
I think that if there is a resulting concern that the reagents are going to be misused, then there may need to be consideration about how to regulate the production of reagents. I don't know that we're necessarily at that point yet, but it is going to have to be part of the debate that we're having. The flip side of democratizing science is that it makes it accessible so that high school students can do it, but jihad high school students potentially can do it as well. And so what constitutes an adequate safeguard there. You know, with regard to the issue of, you know, editing the human germline, we don't have a comparable, you know, regulatory body like the Human Fetal and Embryo Authority that they have in the UK. That said, you know, once people actually started to do it for a therapeutic purpose in humans, the FDA would kick in. But then on the flip side of all of this, Rich, is that in terms of these applications, doing research in human embryos and fetuses, you know, becomes an issue. And that, of course, is one of the very hot button, you know, issues of our time with, you know, stealth, you know, photographers, you know, demonizing organizations and, you know, individuals who are engaging in procuring human materials so that research can be done. And against that whole backdrop, we don't have a common regulatory framework, so that in states like New York and New Jersey and California, we want to encourage, you know, human embryonic stem cell research. You know, in states like South Dakota and Louisiana, it's illegal. So we're all over the board in terms of what's happening in this country.
All right, to end, because we are down to our last 10 minutes, I want to go to each of you, and just in a minute or two, if CRISPR could achieve its promise, what do you see as a future CRISPRized world? What would it look like? And what is your biggest fear or nightmare that could happen if this isn't done properly? Noel.
So my nightmare scenario would be that this genome editing technology isn't deployed fast enough for us to actually feed our growing population. And my dream scenario would be that no woman, no man, woman, or child would die of starvation, that farmers or growers in developing countries are able to sustain themselves, their families, and their surrounding communities. And for CBIS is that we will develop traits in every major crop that will help feed the growing population.
Harry?
Better foods, better medicine is my, you know, for people is my dream. I don't see, you know, human genome editing as a therapeutic, you know, coming on board immediately. My fear, you know, as I alluded to, is bioterrorism.
Ben?
So I work in particular on insects that cause pretty terrible disease, and so I think whether or not it's through gene drive or just simply a better basic biological understanding of these animals in the lab that CRISPR allows us to get towards, the dream is to reduce the impact of these throughout the world. And I think one of my nightmares as somebody who's still at the bench on a daily basis using these tools is that we see either backlash from the public if something is deployed incorrectly, or if we see, conversely, kind of over-regulation of these tools so that we can't deploy them for good. And that's something that I worry about on a daily basis.
And do you see a way to mitigate against that?
I think having conversations like this and thinking before we act and just doing the best science that we can and engaging with the public, I think, are good first steps.
Josie?
I mean, in humans, I see the potential to treat disease and alleviate suffering as the sort of as the dream use. And I guess my nightmare would be that the kind of idea that we are supposed to somehow always be thinking about how we can perfect our children and make them better or improve them, that takes over and really just ultimately changes how it is that we think about what it really means to be a parent, what it really means to be in a parent-child relationship. So I feel like that relationship is really important and very significant in our culture, and just that is able to be preserved and that we're able to be surprised and to cherish and to love in ways that aren't only seeing things through the eyes of, like, how could this have been made better? How could this person be changed? But I think that's a long way off, but that's the direction that I hope we don't go in.
Luke?
So I think in many ways, from a research perspective, and we've realized the dream, it's just a matter of scale now. So my dream in terms of therapeutic application is really somatic gene editing, not germline, but treating these monogenic heritable disorders that are debilitating. And then the nightmare is exactly what Ben said. If something goes wrong and we don't regulate that process, we're going to get the backlash that we got from gene therapy, and then another moratorium on being able to implement the technology where it might be used effectively.
George?
Yeah, I think everybody's pretty well covered most of my nightmares, which I have in abundance. You know, just in quick summary, I would hope that we could feed the population. I think that we can cure a lot of diseases that affect developing nations, because the poverty of the world drags us all down. I think we don't need to worry quite so much about overpopulation, because as people move into the cities and become wealthier, their fecundity drops from 7.5 per family to 1.2, which is below the replacement level. I mean, we should still worry about it, but it's a different discussion.
So is access to technology a dream or a nightmare or both for you?
I think it depends on the technology. So I think cell phones, for example, was once only for rich people and could have melted their brains. Didn't, as far as we know. but now it's successful. Now there's 6 billion cell phones and rising, and getting internet access to the rest of the world is happening. I think the important thing is that we do this very thoughtfully and cautiously, so we don't get the backlashes that we inevitably get when we bring out a technology that was poorly thought out. And there's just this tendency for individuals to rush ahead so they get the big prize.
Yep.
And we need to remove those motivations, because we are, after all, human. And stop giving out prizes for rushing ahead and making a mess.
Well, on that note, I want to first off thank our tremendous panel for, I think, a really thoughtful discussion about a topic I knew very little about before diving into this. But thank you so much for your time and your expertise and all of your perspectives. And I lastly just want to thank all of you for coming tonight. The World Science Festival is going on all weekend. There are events all over the city. Check them out. Explore science. Bring your kids so that they grow up to think that science is cool. Thank you very much.